On this journey to achieving your life's potential, we, Edelweiss Tokyo Life Insurance, will partner you right through. Go on, dream unlimited, dare unlimited, live Zindagi unlimited. Edelweiss Tokyo Life Insurance.
Year 2020 and everything that it brought along has derailed a lot of plans for most of us. But don't let this pause stop you from planning for your long-term goals. So whether you're looking for ways to start investing or still haven't figured out whether you have parked your savings in the right instruments, it's time you get started. Welcome to our special webinar series, Be Future Ready Financially. I'm your host, Pallavi. This is the second session of our series for ET Wealth, where our experts will address all your financial problems, your financial queries, and help you introspect whether you're ready for the future financially. I'm being joined by two of the best names in the industry who will tell us ways to unlock our money's true potential. I'm joined by Mr. Sumit Rai, MD and CEO, Edelweiss Tokyo Life Insurance. Sumit comes with over 20 years of experience in leading and mentoring large cross-functional teams and enhanced organizational value and growth. He's been instrumental in strategic initiatives inclusive of automation, learning programs, market penetration, and talent management. He previously worked with Max Life, Bank of America, and ABN AMRO Bank. I'm also being joined by Feroz Aziz, Deputy CEO, Anand Rathi Private Wealth Management. With a decade's experience in capital markets, Feroz Aziz is known for his radical methods of wealth management and financial engineering. Feroz is a mechanical engineer and also holds a PG diploma in management with majors in derivatives and finance. Has got keen interest in bullying and delivers guest lectures on finance at several B schools. I welcome both of you to the panel.
Thank you, Pallavi.
Thank you, Pallavi.
So, Sumit, I would like to start with you. We are almost at the end of the year. Like, we are approaching the end of this year, which is, of course, likely to be remembered for all the wrong reasons. But in your opinion, with the COVID rates now coming down and there are hopes of an early vaccine, maybe early next year, do you think there is some kind of optimism which is coming back to the investors? What is the thing which is going on in the minds of investors?
What a year it has been, right? I don't think 1st January 2020 anybody imagined what was going to turn out. It's been unusual in that sense. But coming back specifically to what you asked, Pallavi, I think when I see what is happening around with the folks and what they're doing with their savings, I do see a certain degree, maybe not so much optimism, but certainly beginning to look forward and thinking about what to do after what they've experienced in the last few months. Right. So certainly that bit is there. I think if I talk about from a life insurance and a savings perspective, therefore, from that sense, the last 3-4 months have seen a steady growth in interest, which was not the case in the first 2 or 3 months. So there has been a steady increase in interest. In the first 3-4 months, for example, there was a lot of interest in term insurance, but not quite as much in savings. Today, we are seeing a slightly different view. Savings people are interested in. I think one of the things that have happened is this year has forced people to kind of recalibrate their own plans and how they look at financial planning in their lives. You know, a lot of people hadn't anticipated, for example, ever that they would be out of earning for such long periods, right? Especially that's very true for self-employed people. While there is certain uncertainty, I don't think any self-employed model goes on the belief that you might not be earning anything for 3-4 months at all, right? I think some of those basic mental frameworks have changed in people. So I see a lot of people, therefore, for example, asking questions about saying, I need something to ensure that while I'm working and I'm accumulating money, I should also be able to create a future second stream of income for myself that is not dependent on my work, right? So those kind of things, which I've not heard of so much in the past, are becoming a little bit more important. Emergency money is becoming a little bit more important. It maybe was a leverage to emphasize emergency earlier was only for medical reasons. You didn't anticipate being out of job or whatever for a long period of time. So I think, yes, a lot of mental changes happened, but also in general over the last 2-3 months, I do see the belief that, look, life has to carry on. We have to get on with life. We have to do what is required, and let's get on with it, right? And people are beginning to meet their financial advisors. People are beginning to do some of that stuff as well. So overall, yes, there is a certain degree of positivity. There is a certain degree of buoyancy is probably a strong word, but a certain degree of optimism, for sure.
But Viroz, I would like to take your opinion. It's, you know, that time of the year, we've just crossed Diwali. We see a lot of decluttering and cleansing at home. And we, you know, give away things which we don't, you know, no longer need. We add new things to our household. So do you think a similar kind of approach really works or should be there when it comes to our portfolios? We need to declutter our portfolios as well?
Yes, Pallavi, like you said, every Diwali, you may want to have some cleansing activity at home. A portfolio, I think, needs a reason to have a very strong review. So I think Diwali could be a very auspicious time to review your portfolios and take stock and make it contemporary. That's one. Second is, over a period, investors have this tendency of buying products from different service providers. And that automatically creates a huge amount of over-diversification with several line items in their portfolio, which are not relevant. Even a portfolio with 100, 200, 300 crores don't need so many line items, which I see a portfolio with 10 crores has. So point one I'm making is fix a review. I think Diwali is the best time to introspect, take stock. You have more time at hand. Second, I think over-diversification happens in the process of buying and selling products. So making sure that it's not over-diversified, there's statistical answers to what is the maximum number of mutual funds, for example, on the equity side one should have, not more than 8. So you have to try and make your money focus on a fewer things rather than doing too much. Third, I think we as a human race have this tendency of forgetting a lot of experiences we have. I think this corona event and the pandemic will soon be forgotten. That's my fear. We have to derive learnings and write them down so that the longevity of the learning we've had in life is longer, right? So for example, I think what has this year taught us is to not time the market. And try and see that you create opinions which are short-term in nature. Quite a few HNI retail have stayed out of the market thinking that it's overdone. And they've seen one of the biggest rallies ever, from 8,600 on Nifty to wherever we are, close to 13,000 today. So deriving learnings and writing them down is the message for this year I would like to give.
Sumit, as we are referring to the analogy of, you know, how people declutter and cleanse their homes and, you know, how they need to do for the portfolios, we want to understand from you, how does one come to that point of, you know, evaluating and understanding whether they're getting back the full potential of whatever their money is invested in whatever instruments? How does one realize that? How does one evaluate that?
Actually, Pallavi, before that, I think in our country, at least, a lot of people are still a little bit unclear about the financial objectives, the goals that they're kind of saving for, and B, then their risk appetite. You know, what is it that they can afford to do and what is it that they cannot afford to do, given whatever their stage of life and whatever their future stream of income and other things might be. So that is something that I think a lot of people have to focus on, and this is about as good a time as any to, you know, lessons, just as Feroz mentioned, there are lessons this year that are probably very, very valuable. And lessons that we might forget in the euphoria of the good times to come and so on and so forth. But it's important, I think, to start with that, of saying, where am I? What am I saving for? What do I want to put money away for? And how much risk do I want to take? And then you go back and then you look at your asset allocations, where you want to put money, what time frame. And as Feroz also mentioned, look at it regularly, look at it at least once every year to see whether you are doing the right thing. So I think there are some basic fundamentals. Very often for us, you know, investing becomes money making. not necessarily, and a quick this tip here and that tip there, and then you keep accumulating, as Feroz was also mentioning. And then, you know, you just have a whole lot of stuff that you don't know what to do with. And I think this year in that sense has kind of, I think it should hopefully give us all the impetus to go back a little bit to the basics of why we are saving, what are we investing for, what are the frames, what is the risk that we want to take, and therefore, is my current portfolio looking like the one that it should be, or do I need to kind of revisit, do a few other things? It's a good a time as any. I think there's been a lot of introspection in the last 6-7 months. This is another bit of introspection to do, I guess.
In fact, Feroz, as you mentioned, and Sumit just reiterated that, you know, an annual checkup could be really good for your overall financial well-being. And, you know, once in a year, looking at, you know, what all assets you've done. And before, you know, evaluating, it's important to, you know, set goals. Because if you're not setting any goals and just investing just for the sake of it may not really, you know, help us achieve the kind of, you know, targets that we may have. But if I were to look back at least, you know, 10 years and see, you know, from 2010 to 2020, people had such targets, such goals for 2020. But this has been a depressing year, a depressing decade for at least for the equity investors. So if you could share your view, your take of how, you know, equity markets performed in the last 10 years, if you look at the average, we look at some numbers, it comes to below 10%. But then it is very important of when we start and when we, you know, come out of those investments. So if we change the 2010 number to 2009 and instead of 2020, we compare it with 2019, that 1 year will change the entire game for investors. What is your take?
See, I think, Pallavi, there are sources of income. One is the market. The other is what you get extra over and above the market. And how do you get it? So you're right, Pallavi. If you look at the last 10 years, you're sub 10% on equity. And that we are speaking of the largest index of the country, which is Nifty. Okay, a year back, it might have been lower. I think there is a good news and a bad news. The good news is that equity has not finished its rally. Right. If the last 10-year returns have been 9.25, that too after the current rally, that means that return is not behind you. Point one. Point two is that if you get 8-9% from Nifty with some degree of discipline, some degree of intellect, some degree of engineering, you can definitely get a 4-5% more. That's what we have seen at Anand Rathi over the last 8 years. A model portfolio would have beaten the index by 4-5% at half the standard deviation or half the risk, numerically, not in English, numerically, half the risk. If you get 3-4% more than Nifty, then you are at that 12-14%. If you're expecting anything more than that, then it's unfair from an investment which is static, not buying and selling stocks, maybe. So point one I'm making is last 10 years have not been great. That's also good news from a future perspective. Mm-hmm. Point two I'm making is if you've got sub 10, 9-ish kind of returns from Nifty over 10 years compounded, right? Then trying to put in some degree of learnings to get to 13, 14 isn't too difficult to my mind.
In fact, Sumit, as we're discussing that a complete portfolio may not have just an exposure to equity, and of course insurance plays a very, very important role in the overall financial well-being. So if you could tell us, what role can insurance play in the overall financial goals and in the long-term perspective?
That's an interesting one. I think if you look at, in my understanding of financial planning, at least in what I have advised many people followed personally, is that at the very first level, insurance is the foundation of what you need to have in your portfolio, right? Because the risk that you carry, you have every human being is at the end of the day an earning asset. Right? There is a value to life, what we call human life value, right? And what is that life value? And therefore, do you have enough to ensure that this asset, which is going to generate so much, is protected for at least that much? And to my mind, that's the fundamental of all financial planning, because then everything else in life is dependent upon your inflows and your ability to invest some part of that inflow. This is the one piece which is trying to ensure that those inflows, whether you're there or not, should always be there. So to that extent, insurance fundamentally is also very important. Then there is the whole other piece on which a lot of financial experts, and I'm sure Feroz will also disagree, which is that should insurance be a part of savings at all? Now, many schools of thought on that one. My personal school of thought is there are lots of us who are essentially A, not that well informed, B, more problematically, not as disciplined about saving. I think what vehicle insurance do is create a disciplined way of saving. Maybe it doesn't give you as much as some other vehicles might do, and I understand that. But at least ensuring that you put some money away for a certain purpose, for a certain goal in life and all that, right? And to that extent, I think, and that is why insurance is in a lot of ways a fairly well-established and old tool of saving for a lot of middle-class Indians, right? And I think as people go up the, it's like the Maslow's hierarchy, as people go up the income chain, I think the other things, investment, the extra income that Feroz was referring to over and above 50 and all that becomes a lot more important. And it should. But at the very base, I do believe that insurance has a very significant role to play. Protection, protecting the value of your life. Health insurance. Because health is really becoming so much more expensive to manage. So health insurance is a very critical piece. So all kinds of protection that you would do. I mean, I frankly, in this country, sometimes I don't understand. You're happy to pay 50,000 bucks to pay you insure your car. You're not happy to pay 50,000 bucks to insure the person who earned the money to buy the car in the first place, right? It's a little bit of an irony. But so to that extent, I think it's a fundamental thing at the very foundation. Protection is must. And then for a lot of people who may not be disciplined otherwise to save or who may not have enough knowledge, putting money away in insurance savings vehicle is also one thing that they look at. And lots of people do that. A lot of people who are smarter or who understand financial investments better or believe that they can do it better, choose not to do it. And that's fine as well.
I just want to add to what you said. People, they would not mind paying 50,000 for their car, but not for the breadwinner or the bread earner. But I think it is also to do with the stigma which is attached to insurance. People don't want to talk about death in the family. They don't want to talk. They don't want to, you know, discuss it. So, of course, then buying and going and buying the term insurance then comes at the later stage. So, what is your take? Is this trend going to change? Because of this year, because we've seen things which we've not seen earlier. So will 2020 will be a game changer for insurance? At least people have started, you know, going and searching for insurance policies. So do you think, in your opinion, this year is going to be a game changer?
Pallavi, actually, the game has started changing about 2-3 years ago, right? People were actually seriously thinking of term insurance even 2-3 years ago. So if you look at the term insurance market, for example, it's the one part of the insurance business which has been growing for at about 70-80% for the last 3-4 years at a steady clip, right? Two things, I think, have contributed. A, the increasing education. B, the sheer amount of information that is now available online, right? By one estimate, Google published a statistic about 2.5 years ago, I think, which said about 62% of all people who buy insurance at some point of time go online and search. Right. So what was essentially always seen as a product that nobody wanted and that people had to push is slowly, at least at the protection end of it, certainly becomes a little bit more of a product. More people understand the need for it. What I think Corona has done is increase that factor about the uncertainty of life to a much higher level. Whether it will sustain or not is a question that is difficult to answer. You know, after every major epic event, we see this. There is a big earthquake, you see this. The big floods somewhere, you see this. And then human mind being what it is, it kind of reverses to time, right? Maybe because this has been such a long-lasting event, maybe this will alter behavior more fundamentally is, I think, what could happen. But we'll have to wait and see. So far, over the last 4-5 months, I think the general awareness about insurance term has taken a significant jump as reflecting in buying behavior. That's a big thing. So let's see. Hopefully, this is a welcome change in behavior that's going to stick for a while.
In fact, Feroz, another reason for people not buying insurance is that it's a long-term commitment. But then it applies to other instruments also, be it equity or be it, you know, the other kind of instruments that we have. So in your opinion, if somebody is to, you know, invest for say 10 to 15 years, how does one make sure that the long-term plans are not derailed despite of a crisis like COVID-19? What is your opinion?
See, like Sumit said, one is the product itself instills discipline, or you have to be disciplined yourself. Point one, do people stay the course for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years? I think that's also going through a paradigm shift. Earlier, they wouldn't. The average life of an equity folio has doubled over the last 5 years. What people used to do was they would get some profits, they would book it, then they would go elsewhere, they would try to time the market. But I think education, which SEBI initiated in 2013 by creating a corpus to educate people, has brought a behavioral change in terms of thinking long term, which Indians were not acclimatized to. Point one. Point two, either you're self-disciplined or start buying products, like Sumit said, which instill discipline and don't leave you a choice. Point two. Point three is whenever you get tempted to do something which is momentary, short-term, look at data, right? Anybody who looks at data will take more prudent decisions. For example, in March 2020 or April 2020, if you looked at your 3-year return, you would have been in the negative zone. But if you went back and saw the worst 10-year return of equity mutual funds, for example, has been double digit for the old funds, which have been there for 30 years, and that's adequate data. So look at data before you take decisions, not just that experience, but if you look at 20, 30-year data of 10-year investing, it has always been in the double digit. Is that calmness enough for you to stay the course? That's very critical for you to look at data. Make sure that you buy products if you're not self-disciplined. The product itself should force you to be in it. And I think, but there is a clear trend of Indians becoming more long-term, people speaking the right language. If on a TV show today we get queries, people refer to long-term as 5 and 10 years. Earlier, people would say, I want to invest for the long-term. It's 1.5 years. So I think that definition seems to be progressing pleasingly. So,
In fact, we're talking about different kinds of investments. Sumit, I want to know from you, can insurance needs also be customized according to one's age and one's requirements? What are the different factors which, you know, which impact and which should influence our insurance choices, our insurance decision?
So I think there are two or three things that I think are important when you're talking about insurance. And insurance, again, has two different purposes to it. There is a large protection purpose to it. But for many, many large number of Indians, it's also a savings vehicle that they use, right? Firstly, like I said earlier also, as a very foundation of your financial planning, having insurance, maybe just pure protection, if that's what you can afford at that point of time. But having enough to safeguard your earnings from a 5 to 10 year perspective is a must, right? So if whatever you earn today, 5 times that is something, 5 to 10 times that is something that you should certainly put away, to my mind. Beyond that, and within that, then there are multiple ways of customizing, right? You can customize it to say that you want don't want a lump sum, you want it in annuity form, you want a lump sum, or, you know, a lot of people, for example, ask this question that, you know, if something was to happen to me, my wife may not be able, or my spouse may not be able to manage all this large inflow and how to invest in all that. So are there other ways of kind of ensuring that there is a more steady income which kind of comes in every year? And so those kind of vehicles have also been created now where people can choose to say, you know, instead of giving me one large lump sum, give me an X amount of money every year that can be put away, and you invest the balance and you keep giving the return. So I think those options exist today. Beyond that, what insurance also does today is between the base products and the riders, which is, you know, if I was to give you an analogy, it's like a pizza and the toppings on the pizza. Your base insurance is nothing but the base of the pizza, and then you put the various toppings as per your choice. So there's so much today, and even within your base today, you can add so much more to customize it just to your requirements. So how much money do you want to pay? When do you want to pay? When do you want money back? What kind of protection do you want? Do you believe that at a relatively young age, you want to keep, let's say, pure life insurance down a little bit, but add a top up of accidental death benefit, because that is something that's going to, that could hurt you at some point of time. So there are a lot of options that are available today from an average customer's perspective, both on the protection side as well on the savings side. So, you know, if you today want to buy a plain vanilla product, you can buy a plain vanilla product where you have 4 years, but you could also have a different variation which says, you know, by the way, if something happens to me during the payment period, I will pay a little bit extra. That will ensure that this benefit will still accrue even if I'm not. So if the money is needed 10 years from now, something happens to me, let's say 3 years later, I don't want this money coming in 3 years. Keep the money, pay it out at the 10 years, and pay it out in such a way that it looks like I've paid my premium for all 10 years, right? So it's called, let's say, waiver of premium. So things like that do add a lot of flexibility and a lot of options to customers of what they do and how they can customize it to their own requirement. So yes, I think over the last 10 years, the business has evolved significantly. There are today guaranteed income plans. There are ULIP plans, and so for different kind of customers with different kinds of risk appetites and so on, I think there are lots of options available today that consumers can choose from.
Right. In fact, Feroz, this session is not just for people who are starting their investment. It's also for those who are already invested some more money and they're looking for better revenues. But it also is a fact that by the time an individual explores better avenues, a lot of time has passed, you know, the time where wealth accumulation, as we call it. So can someone cover up that loss of starting late by changing the strategy? What should be the ideal investment strategy if somebody's starting late, and what are the types of investments one can look at?
See, in our opinion, if somebody is starting late, or starting early, the guy who's starting early has a very big advantage because it has the eighth wonder of the world, as they call it. The power of compounding comes in the favor of a person who began late. If it's already late and you've not started as yet, irrespective if your time frames are 5 years and 10 years, equity will be the backbone of your strategy. The first thing which a wealth management strategy needs is the asset allocation. Then it needs the product selection. And then it needs the risk mitigants. If all this is there, is when the strategy is formulated. So equity will be the backbone of the strategy. Why? Because if you have to beat inflation, you will have to have equity and real estate. These are the two asset classes in the long run which have shown the capability of beating inflation. Gold and debt could be your protection assets. So in these four assets, what proportion goes into which asset class is the first decision you'll have to make, which can help you achieve the goal you've set for yourself. So equity, larger equity components. Real estate, we have been negative. We have written articles and done a lot of interaction on, for the last 5 years, we've been negative on real estate, continue to be negative on residential metro real estate. So leaves you with equity. Equity has to be 60-70% of one's portfolio. Second, gold can definitely form a part of the protection side, especially on the sovereign gold bond funds, gold bonds, which give you a tax-free income if held till maturity, which is one of the very, very important feature, just like insurance does. And it also gives you a recurring income. So point one, have the backbone as equity. Point two, make sure that what are the products you're not going to buy is decided. For example, in Anand Rathi, for the last 8 years, we have banned several product lines except mutual funds and structure products and term plans on the insurance side. So if you know what's not to be done, half the job is done. So make sure that you're not getting very adventurous. That's one. So that's the product selection. And if you, third, have a clear monitoring mechanism. People go wrong and they stick to their mistake for long periods of time. That's where the damage is done. We all are going to go wrong. How soon you correct your mistake will determine its impact. So these are the few important things to keep in mind when you're starting late, because your capability to undo a mistake is lower. So be more agile, more vigilant, have a very good monitoring mechanism of all the constituents of your portfolio is what you'll have to do, additional to a person who begins 20 years earlier than you did. So he has room for error, which you don't.
Right. In fact, Sumit, we're talking about different mistakes also. So could you tell us what are the biggest myths around insurance? And, you know, one instrument may be suitable for one individual, it may not be suitable for the other person. So as I earlier also asked that, what are the factors which determine which policy would suit me? And, you know, would it also depend on my age? You could tell us something around that.
That's an interesting question. And insurance is widely misunderstood. It is also misunderstood because I think the product inherently is, over the period of years, become a little bit complex. Lots of different features are targeted at a lot of different customers, which often end up kind of confusing customers a little bit, right? Having said that, I strongly believe that insurance today offers so many options that it is possible, like I said earlier also, to customize something that is unique to yourself, right? But what is important, therefore, to be able to leverage that is to know what you want, right? And then also to do a little bit of research yourself to say, what I want, how can I get it in insurance, and who can offer it to me, right? Now, traditionally, that research for most people has been done through insurance agents. But today, you can go and do the same thing online, and lots of people prefer to do it themselves online. And that's fine too. There's nothing wrong with it. That's perfectly fine. I think there's a lot of information that is now available. But I think the biggest myth about insurance is that, you know, insurance is for death. Okay. And the fact is that 90% of the insurance that is sold in country is never bought for purposes of death, you know, or protection in that sense. 90% of the insurance that gets sold in this country is sold for saving for the long term. Now, whether you're saving it for your child's wedding or your child's education, or whether you're saving it for your retirement, whether you're saving it for that house that you fancy house that you want to think of 15, 20 years later, people have different goals, but they buy it for those. But the general belief and the first reaction for most people is, mujhe life insurance mujhe kyun chahiye? Sab theek hai. Ek, for some strange reason, we are all immortal in this country till the time something happens. But on a more serious note, I think the biggest myth about insurance is that it is purely for protection. It is not. It has more purposes. And like all savings instruments, some people will find it more useful. Some people will find it less useful. Some people might find other things to be more attractive. But is insurance, to my mind at least, a mandatory thing for every individual? Yes, it is. 100% it is. And certainly you should, like I had said earlier also, between 5 to 10 times your current annual income, you should always have life insurance for that much. Whether then that is pure protection or whether that is through a mixture of protection and savings policies, that is up to an individual and what is it and how do they look at their portfolio, that's entirely their choice.
Well, I would like to come back to complete the thought, Pallavi, just to add to that.
I think I meet a lot of customers who say, you know, I have a lot of assets, I don't need insurance. But insurance also has multiple uses, and I've seen people use insurance very, very innovatively. So, for example, I've seen large business families use insurance to carve out different inheritances for the children. Right? And so there are many, many different use cases that people are finding for insurance. Lots of people, especially businessmen, use insurance for under the Married Women Protection Act, MWPA, to create a set of inheritances that are completely protected from any kind of banks or whatever, especially for business people with their debts and other things. So they're using it very differently. So insurance is not just a plain vanilla simple protection product. It has many more uses. And it can be used by different sets of segments in very different way and very, very effectively.
Probably you summarized everything, because that's exactly a point of the session, that people do not know why they need a particular instrument and whether they, you know, it suits them or not. So that is the purpose of this whole session. So coming back to you, Feroz, there is a tendency among investors of comparing, and they don't set their independent goals. They kind of compare their life goals with their colleagues, maybe their friends and their relatives. In your opinion, how does that hamper their own financial goals?
So people would compare, but I would be happy if they did. But quite a few people don't think enough about goals. They don't even spend a weekend on goal setting. If you have to do any kind of management, you will have to have a clearly defined objective. That's when you can draw up a strategy. So spending time on a goal itself is great. Interacting with people on different people's goal to get a sense of what your goal should be, I think there's no harm doing that. But what's personal in personal finance is the goal setting. Goal setting and creating two buckets of goals, one which are must have, the other are good to have. If you categorize both of them, found out what is the kind of investing you will need to do on a recurring basis to meet this bucket, how much would you need for this bucket on a monthly basis, and then chipping in from your recurring income is what I think is the most important step, which has been forgotten. People buy and sell products without a context. So Pallavi, there's no harm people discuss goals and derive some learnings from each other, but doing it and trying to make sure that goal setting is done properly and prioritized properly. For example, quite a few people would prioritize a child's marriage to their retirement. But retirement is something nobody is going to fund you for, right? Marriage, maybe the child would be earning to fund his own marriage or education. So retirement gets lesser emphasis. The whole social fabric which India had, that the child would take care of the parent when they retire, is changing dramatically, and we're getting westernized there. So you'll have to plan for your retirement. 20 years from now, 30 years from now, the child might not be financially taking care of a retired parent. So point one, goal setting is important. Spending that time is important. Prioritizing them is important. Then working backwards to come to the numerical value of it is very important. And then trying to find out how much of my salary should be invested. And post that is when comes expenditure. You have to spend what is left after investment rather than invest what is left after spending.
Right. Right, on that note, let's start with the Q&A session. But before we move on to the questions, one question from Sumit. We're talking about how 2020 has taught a lot of things in terms of money. So if you were to tell us, what is the top three priorities for an individual at this point in time? And also, you think not only just financial, but the medical needs that have come into picture. People have started thinking about it.
Actually, the more we do goal setting with individuals, the more we realize that actually the goals aren't really changing. Okay, there are a couple of things happening, and let's discuss about it. I think fundamentally, saving for retirement, saving for child education, saving for marriage are three big goals that I think Indians have saved for generations for, right? But in addition, as we talk to customers now, we are seeing some new things emerge. Okay. I think the new generation is increasingly moving towards a more consumption mindset, right? Increasingly, saving today is also about saying, I want to do that vacation 4 years down the line, 5 years down the line, the big one. And so how do I save for that? So those are new things. They did not exist in India till even about 7-10 years ago, right? But those are new that are coming in. So consumption and saving for consumption is becoming a very big thing. I think we are becoming a little bit more westernized in some of our attitudes, in that, our mindset traditionally had been save first, then spend. The mindset is moving to spend first and then save through loans and EMIs and all of that. And I think that's become quite big. But all of that is emerging behavior. It is behavior that we are seeing emerge. But certainly, savings for consumption is the big trend that we are seeing. And consume and spend is the other big trend that we are seeing. So I think both of them are linked to. And it kind of shows up, our savings rate has fallen significantly over the last 2 to 3 years, right? And I think some of it is kind of bearing out. Some part of it also may be that the economy has seen a little bit of difficult time. Incomes have maybe kind of reduced a little bit. And also confidence has kind of gone down. But while the old saving goals are pretty much there, I think there are new behavior trends that are emerging, and that can change the landscape of savings very significantly over the next 3 to 5 years.
On that note, let's start with the Q&A. I'll start with Sumit first. Sumit, the first question that we've received is from Prem, and he says, please suggest investment options in the current scenario. When he mentions current scenario, he's referring to the markets, which are at record highs, and there is a news of vaccine coming in early, and he would like to invest for next 5 to 10 years. What is your advice to him? What should be the strategy?
Well, at least Prem has validated Firoz's point that people have started talking of 5-year and 10-year as a long-term piece. That's the first thing that comes out of that. Having said that, I think, to my mind, again, I would suggest that before I talk about investments, without knowing what kind of goals Prem is looking at, what does he want to save money for, what are the important milestones and landmarks that Prem wants to save for. In the absence of that, it's going to be a little bit difficult to say what exactly should be the instruments. But I would say, I think as Paul also mentioned earlier, over a 5-year, 10-year period, if you have that kind of a horizon, that equity is clearly an important part of what you want to do. And you don't necessarily want to dabble in equity, if, direct equity, if you don't understand it as well. There are many mutual funds that one can do that. So you look at that entire thing. What is your asset allocation? How much money do you want to keep in debt? How much you want to keep relatively liquid versus how much can you afford not to touch at all for the next 5 to 10 years? Those are important factors that come into play. Also, what is your age? What kind of health issue could arise? If you're older, you need to put away more for health insurance and stuff like that. If you're younger, maybe you don't need to put away as much. You can grow it as you go along. So that's the whole protection aspect of it, about how much you want to put away, how much emergency cash do you want to put away. All of that, I think, is the other piece to think of. But yeah, a good starting point is to say, what is my goal? What do we want to do with this? And what is my risk appetite? How much risk am I willing to take? And then allocate your assets accordingly. I think it's a good starting point at this point of time. And a certain degree of protection, health and term, is also a good starting point.
Has to be a right mix of different instruments. Let's move on to the next question. This is for Firoz. Firoz, there's a viewer named Hiten who has asked this question. He says, what is the most effective way to become debt-free? He hasn't mentioned what all responsibilities or loans he has on his on himself, but what are the ways that can make him debt-free in lesser time?
If you ask my suggestion of how to become debt-free, one thing which is very critical is bad debt has to be classified. You'll have to arrange your debt in the descending order of interest rate. For example, if you cleared all your loans but are left a credit card balance of 50,000 rupees for the next 5 years, you'll be surprised at what kind of amounts you'll have to end up paying, because the rates could be as high as 30-35%. So identifying, arranging your debt, current debt, in the descending order, that's one very important thing. Good debt can last. For example, a home loan today, I would call it a good debt because the interest rates have fallen. You get tax breaks, immense amount of tax break for an affordable home if you're living in one. And third, that there is a possibility that it'll give you some appreciation. It was also saving you the rent. So that's not one debt which you even need to aspire to close down. That's the great news. You just need to optimize it. You might want to take a floating interest rate, which is a floater account, as they call it in some banks, where you pay back the money for 1 month and you don't get charged. So categorize the debt into two categories: bad ones. Make sure that you bring down your discretionary spending for a period. Discretionary spending, by which I mean spending which you can avoid and you can live without. You can't live without groceries at home. You can't live without paying the electricity bill. But there's so much discretionary spending. When we looked at some credit card data of HNIs, we realized discretionary spending in HNIs was 78%. Was discretionary spending. Maybe for a person in the early part could be 30% of discretionary. Cut down the discretionary spend for a period of 1-2 years to zero. And that's, if you did that and got rid of the bad debt which is compounding against you, you will be debt-free. So discipline, some degree of planning, some degree of intellect in terms of trying to see which are the ones which the bank is actually penalizing you far more than you deserve is a good start point. And then everything else is individualistic and somebody has to customize his way out of debt.
The next question is for Sumit, and a female viewer. She says, how much emergency fund would be ideal, and would it also depend on the insurance coverage one has?
Yes. Okay. So typically, thumb of rule, 6 months of monthly spending is what we advise a lot of people to put away as emergency cash funding. Within that, I think, where do you use emergency cash funds for typically? I think they happen in two situations for most of us, either in an urgent medical situation for some reason or the other, or they might happen if, for example, you have a job loss, a sudden job loss or something like that, and there is a disruption in cash flow. Job loss or a business shutdown or whatever that might be. Those are the two, to my mind, are situations where emergency cash flows come into equation. For the first, having health insurance and having adequate health insurance can certainly help you reduce your emergency cash requirements to an extent. However, do remember that health insurance will only provide for, let's say, the amount of money that you actually spend on your health issue. You still have, let's say, an income disruption that will happen because you will probably not be able to go to work or whatever. And if you're lucky, you'll have income coming in. But if you're not lucky and you're in your self-employed or whatever, you have income coming from that route, then you have to supplement that income. So keep in mind those situations and keeping in mind the nature of your work. You can decide. So if you have a health insurance or if you have an accidental insurance of some variety, those can help you reduce your emergency cash a little bit. But I would still suggest that those are supplementary. You should still have anywhere between 4 to 6 months of cash of your monthly expenses in cash at least with you at all given points of time is the way we have always advised people.
So the next question is for Firoz now, and it's sent by Pranav. I think he seems to be a bit confused. He wants to know where would he get maximum returns, whether in mutual funds or FDs, and what is the risk associated? So if you could briefly tell us, these are two completely different instruments, but where and how much should he be investing?
See, mutual fund is a platform. It's not even a product to my mind. If it can encompass three different asset classes with three different kinds of behaviors, gold, debt, and equity, it's no more a product, it's a platform. So FD, if you're comparing an FD kind of an instrument, the right like-to-like comparison would be a debt fund. If you're in the highest tax bracket, then a debt fund can do justice because there is going to be tax efficiency, which is going to be enormous. And in any ways, in a fallen interest rate environment, if you're going to get 4.5% in an FD and then going to pay 35% tax, in India it can go as high as 42.7% of tax, then you're left with very little. So debt funds would win hands down for a person who has himself in the highest tax bracket. Otherwise, also debt funds would be a very, very good instrument because large corporates also use that same platform for lacks of growth. So 1 to 1.5% more than an FD for a given period could be achieved in low expense debt funds. But having said which, if a person is open to the mutual fund platform as a whole, I think creating a mix of equity and debt, very well thought out, very well chosen funds, because there are 500, close to 457 equity funds. There might be a few thousand debt funds. So what you choose will determine how much return you got, because the best equity fund and the worst equity fund has a 20% difference every year. So it's also about the choice which an advisor should be able to do for you amongst all these hundreds of funds which are there.
So moving on to the next question, this is for Sumit, and Purva has sent us this question. She says, is saving retirement good enough for having a good life? And what about the current expenses? So the main problem or the challenge which she faces, or I think most of the investors face, is about balancing the saving with the expenses. What's your take, Sumit?
That's an interesting one, actually. And I will kind of refer back first to something that Firoz said earlier and let me put it slightly differently. Fundamentally, life is about paying yourself first, right? So you earn money every month, you pay yourself first, right? Some part of it is what I think Firoz was referring to earlier as going into savings. So I pay myself first, and that is the money that I put into my savings. The next bit of money is for, let's say, what Firoz referred to as discretionary a little bit, because I think that's also the question that I'm kind of hearing, if my understanding is correct. How do I balance both the saving and the current discretionary and enjoy good life today and enjoy good life in retirement? And I think you need to be clear about what kind of discretionary, how much discretionary can you afford, but pay yourself first for both and then everything else. And that then, you know, kind of forces you into the discipline of saying all your other expenses will stay only in so much, and you have to manage that. But if, and it's a certain bit of discipline at the end of the day, right? Everything around financial planning is about a certain degree of discipline, doing what you set out to do on a very regular basis. So if you can follow that discipline, it can. I know of a lot of people, for example, who have their salary account and saving account as different accounts, or who have their earning account and saving account as different. As soon as the money comes into the earning account, some part of it is automatically sent into a saving account, which is used only for the purpose of saving and never for the purpose of spending, right? Mm-hmm. So people do all kind of different things to drive discipline. And a lot of this is, at the end of the day, it's about discipline, about doing the right things. We all intuitively know what is the right thing. I think we are all reasonably smart people, human beings are smart. And we all intuitively know what is the right thing to do. It usually is the discipline to do the right thing that is lacking. And discipline is a very important virtue when it comes to financial planning.
Firoz, the next question is for you. And it's sent by Prasad Rao. It's a very interesting question. He says that he wants to learn about different types of investments and more about investments which suit better to individuals in the age of 50. So he's not rightly mentioned his age, but I believe he's 50 or around 50. And could there be some funds, or could there be some options for a person who's, you know, towards the retirement age?
If somebody is towards the retirement age, first, having the inclination to learn is very, very heartening to hear, right? It's not like I wish to invest, I wish to hear. So this is a very different question from Mr. Rao. That's very encouraging. Second is learning, optimal learning. See, not learning too many things is also very critical. Filtering what you have to learn, you learn a few things, but more in detail than getting a sense of too many things, to my mind. So what should you learn? You have to learn mutual funds as a platform. Okay. And in that learning, you will have to remove the clutter. SEBI has some 16 odd debt categorizations. There are about 10 odd equity mutual fund categorizations. Identify that 4 or 5 categories across debt and equity, which you need to learn, which is large cap funds, mid cap funds, multi cap funds to begin with. To make sure if you've learned this in detail, on the debt category, if you learned short term funds, dynamic bond funds, and banking PSU funds, this should be your start point. If you've learned these 7 categories in mutual funds, you can ignore the rest of the 20. Across debt and equities. So that's the second point I would want to make to Mr. Rao. The third thing, which at Anand Rathi we've been doing for the last 9 years, and that's created immense value for our clients, our friends, ourselves, is something called structured products. Structured products have delivered about 7-8% alpha on Nifty for the last 8-10 years, the products which we've designed. So understanding structured products, in fact, Edelweiss is also another very important issue in the marketplace, like Sumit Bhai would agree. So that's a very important product for Indian context, which has a relatively higher interest and higher volatility. That would be my tip for Mr. Rao.
So the next question that I'm taking up is by Shubham, and this one is for Sumit. I found it very interesting. You may share your thoughts on it. The question says that me and my wife both have mutually agreed not to have kids because we can't afford the extra expenses that will follow that, which includes studies and, you know, further the marriage of the child. So Shubham wants to say that both are working. Should we be buying a term plan but we don't have any dependents. So would this product term insurance would suit us? Should we go for it or should we not?
I think it's a very unique situation. It's something that I've heard for the first time, quite frankly. My personal belief is that term insurance still might be required, maybe not to the same extent. Earlier I mentioned 5 to 10 times your annual income, maybe not to the same extent. When the two people are earning, there is a certain financial income that's accrued in the house. If one was to suddenly go away, standard of life would get impacted compounding, right? Because the income is going away. So you may not want the full replacement or the full 5 or 10 times your annual income kind of replacement, but certainly term insurance would still be recommended because there is a financial impact of an earning member not being around, right? So to that extent, I think it's still a no-brainer that you should have a term insurance. How much and for how long is something that you see depending on your current age and earning profile and how things would look maybe a few years from now, decide accordingly.
Next question is specific to equity markets, and I will take it up from Firoz. Firoz Sampath Kumar has sent us this question. He says that the market is booming right now and folks like me, like he's retired, he's mentioned that, they would like to look at it, but at the same time, they are kind of scared of equity markets. So he's looking for some safe avenue, safe options, but still he's kind of attracted by the market move. What should he be doing at this age, at this juncture in the markets?
See, this, in our opinion, it's a myth that post-retirement you can't have equity. We looked at the data, the average life of a specific Indian male was close to 80 odd years. So post-retirement, you have 15 to 20 years. That's by any stretch of imagination long enough to compartmentalize your retirement corpus as the corpus which you're going to use in the next 5, 10 years, the one which you will need beyond the 10 years. We at India may go through a low interest rate, high inflation environment for the next 1-2 years. Which implies that the power of your money, which you've kept aside for retirement, will keep diminishing at a pace which is what inflation is going to do to you. So equity, your interest towards equity is valid and it has to be there. It is not a good to have asset. It is a must have asset in the right proportion. Then coming to the contemporary situation of where the markets have reached today, we think that the markets have reached where they have because of different reasons. One is that India is getting a lot of foreign flow, especially in this month, because our weightage in the indices outside has gone up. One. Second, in India, because interest rates have come down to 4 or 5%, historically we Indians are used to 8-9%, which is now 4-5%. People are compelled to move money from debt to equity. So equity will have this push of liquidity globally and domestically. So it'll generally be on the higher side. Of course, you will see those 5-10%, 15% corrections once every year. You will have to create an appetite for that risk of a short-term 10% fall on value. And it is something which you should convert from interest to action, in my opinion.
In fact, Sumit, a lot of our viewers have sent a similar kind of question. So I would like to take up one from you. This is by Srinivas, and he's also around the age of 50. He says, what are the best investment options at the age of 50 years? So would you agree with what Firoz said, or you have your own opinion about it? What could be the possible ways of starting investment at the age of 50, which is very close to the retirement age?
Actually, I would quite agree with Firoz. I would have no disagreement with what Firoz just recommended because, yes, Firoz, right, if you're going to have exposure for the next or you need money for the next 25, 30 years in your retirement and all, and with interest rates being where they are and likely to be where they are, inflation being higher than it has been for the past few years, I think equity exposure is a must. The only thing that I would add that Firoz has also mentioned earlier is having clear view of when you need how much money and therefore building your cash flows accordingly. You can't afford to put money that you're going to need in 1 year or 2 years or 3 years into equity, but certainly money that's going to be there for 5 years or more or 10 years or more is that you could expose the equity and have the more liquid kind of requirements be parked in things like debt and FDs and others. Feroz mentioned structured products. I think structured products is also one great way of creating some of those cash flows. They also help you there. Insurance, for example, today also offers a lot of products that offer you fixed income at a fairly attractive rate in 5, 7, 10 years time. So a lot of different avenues are available, which can create those kind of avenues. But on a long-term basis, yes, I think the traditional belief that equity is not for people who retired is, I think, defunct now. I don't think it applies to today's market and today's set of people who are retiring. But at the same point of time, a fair sense of asset allocation and knowing what kind of cash you might require when and planning accordingly your asset allocation is very important.
We'll take up two more questions. To Ganesh, short of time. So the last question for Feroz would be from Sharmugam Ganeshan, and he says, how to get some fixed income other than fixed deposits or bonds? So you've already talked about fixed deposits and bonds. So what are the other options which can give fixed income?
What can give you fixed income other than the insurance platform, which Sumit Saab would be best equipped to answer? I would say the most tax-efficient way of getting a recurring income is to buy a debt fund and do a systematic withdrawal plan. Whenever you're getting recurring income, it's very important to not pay a large portion of it as taxes, right? So you'll have to buy a debt fund, work backwards, and if you took 0.5% of the value, for example, for every 1 lakh rupee investment, you can take a 500 rupee systematic withdrawal plan from it. Then the tax is going to be very efficient and it will be consistent enough to hit your bank account on the specific date you would have instructed the asset management company. So at the end of 3 years, if that's a 3-year kind of a package you're doing in terms of tailoring it for yourself, you will realize that your capital will be intact and the usage of the 5.5-6% which you have taken as systematic withdrawal plan, that's abbreviated as SWP, is something which a person needs to read up more about and use it to his or her advantage.
So, in fact, so would you like to add something to this? Maybe the viewer can get a broader perspective of where all can get fixed income options besides the one that Feroz mentioned.
So I think insurance income plans today are pretty attractive. Some of the plans there can give you anywhere between 5.5 to 6 tax-free, which in effect is fairly efficient. So those are good avenues and a lot of people are actually participating in it right now. And those are kind of also guaranteed. So it's not as if you're dependent on market performance or whatever. Those are guaranteed from day one. And again, you can create your own cash flows depending on whether you need money monthly, you need money annually, you need money half yearly, whatever it is. You have the ability to kind of utilize or tier your cash flows in the way that you need them quite effectively. So I think for somebody who is at 50 and looking to build an income of that variety, I think that is one option. The other option, not very tax efficient, unfortunately, is also annuity products that come from various insurance companies. But unfortunately, the tax regime on annuities is still a little bit harsh to my mind. And so that kind of hampers. But there are some very interesting annuity options also today available and very attractive annuity options that are available. So that's another flow, a way of creating some income. The difference between annuity and life insurance income products, to my mind, largely lies in the tax efficiency of the insurance products and how you can save a lot, how that can add up a significant dose to your, you know, savings over a period of time.
We'll take a one last question for the session. This is by Bhuva Ghosh, and he's already retired. He says he's 67. He wants to save for two of his grandsons. One is age 4 and one is at the age of 8. Considering inflation and, you know, other factors that we discussed throughout the session, what could be the possible ways you would like to suggest something?
So, actually, I think Feroz would be better positioned to answer this one than I am, given the age of the kids and all that. I think this is better answered by Feroz.
So, Feroz, you would like to give some suggestions for the viewer?
Sure, Pallavi. I think if you are at the age of 67, did I hear that right, Pallavi?
Yeah, he's 53 born, and he says he wants to consider inflation and invest for two of his grandsons. One is 4 and the other is 8 years.
Great. If the money is going to be consumed by the grandchild and it's not going to be consumed by the person who's actually earned it, then the strategy should be dependent on the child and not the current custodian, which is him. So point one, if there is 4 and 6 years as the age of your grandchild, you have at least 10, 15 years of investing life. I would say about 80% in equity is critical in this situation, so that you can get that 12, 13% return. Because inflation, if it aggregated at 6%, inflation, which is published by RBI, may not be relevant to you and me. RBI publishes inflation, which assumes 40-50% of it is used for food, and petrol and diesel bills could be, transport could be 20%. So point one I'm making is 80% equity. Point two, inflation, which RBI publishes, is not relevant to the 1-2% of India, which is not living hand to mouth. So that inflation, which is called the mass affluent inflation, is at 9-10%. So to beat that, you will need 80% in equity and use mutual funds and structure products. I think some insurance platforms where there is guaranteed return in a falling interest rate scenario. These three vehicles can help your grandchildren have a reasonable corpus when they become adults.
I hope that answers the question. That brings us to the end of the Q&A session. It was a wonderful interactive session. Thank you, both of you all, for being with us on the panel. And for all the viewers who are watching us, stay tuned. We'll be coming up with some more sessions for Be Future Ready Financially series. Thanks for being with me.
Thank you, Pallavi.
Thank you, Pallavi.